Hi, this is CCB Gart calling live from the Friendship. You are listening to the Legacy Podcast, the EVE Online podcast for all Catchuleers.
Hello and welcome to Legacy. This is episode 3, and today I'll be joined by Locke Fox, Rick Javix, and Steve Roken. Legacy, everybody. My name is Tyron Scorn, and tonight we have a very busy show with a lot of guests. So I would like to kick it off with some introductions to who everybody is and where everybody came from. Let's go from top to bottom. Phoenix, introduce yourself. Who you are, where did you come from, what do you do?
Alright, I'm Phoenix. I'm living in the Netherlands. Play a lot of games online. Especially EVE Online. So that's me.
Alright, and you are my second in command at Strategic Tactics and Recon, correct?
Correct.
Alright. Locke Fox.
Hey, I am Locke Fox. I run the EVE Prosper Market Show and do a lot of DevFleet API Warrior stuff.
What do you do? You know, for when you want to relax, what do you do in EVE Online? Do you do missions or?
Well, now this is my secret shame, is that I have a hard time actually coming back into EVE because it takes a lot of, it's hard to play EVE for less than 1 hour at a in a block. But I play a crap ton of Rocket League.
Oh, God, dear.
Truckloads of Rocket League. I have like 4,000 games and I'm still not any good.
Rick's.
Yeah, hey, I'm Rick Javix, and I don't know, I do a lot of art. I run an alliance called A Band Apart, and a pirate corporation called Stay Frosty, and do a lot of stuff like that, and cause a lot of trouble, so that's also me.
Do you guys have the mentality of everything that comes through our systems is gonna die?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, that's a man to my heart. That's I like to hear that. Steve.
Hi, I'm Steve Nooken. I'm currently on the CSM, going for re-election, so vote for me. And I do third-party stuff within EVE. I build applications. I make stuff available for other people to build applications within EVE itself. I manufacture stuff. I do missions. I do mining. I do PI, etc. Classic high-sec care bear.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, I hope this is gonna be the CSM for the high seekers this year.
Yeah, because, definitely.
Yeah, I hope so, because you know, the war decking can use some work, I guess. You know, maybe iterate on. I don't know, ganking mechanics. I mean, I'm ganking a lot of people in wormhole space, so I shouldn't really be talking about ganking, but. I don't know, for high sec, maybe you can use some touch-up work, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. I don't think anyone would say it's in a good position, wherever it is, whichever side they're on. That's not just ganking, that's war decks and so on.
Yeah. I've even heard today, I think, like the idea floating around that there's going to be an anti-bumping mechanic. I don't know if I agree with that, because... last week I got my first Orca heal, which I wouldn't be able to make if the bumping mechanic didn't exist. So I would personally be against that, but if you're a miner in high sec, I could kind of agree with that. Like, I don't know. If it's gonna be a high sec focused CSM this year, you guys have a lot to talk about.
Oh, definitely. I don't think there's going to be a large high sec focus. It's just useful to have the voices for the stuff which is talked about.
I've got a couple of subjects that are on my mind, which I would love to talk to you guys about. Most of us, I think four of the five people here are pretty big content creators, either through art, YouTube, podcasting, or third-party tools that you guys do. I've been kind of going back and forth with CCP about maybe the reward system for third-party developers and content creators such as fan sites and stuff like that, and I would love to see maybe an increase or a better system to reward these people, because we spend a lot of time out of game to create content for the community, and I can honestly say I don't get anything out of it, and that's not really the goal, but a better reward system would maybe motivate me even more to go out there and do stuff on a more regular basis, because right now it's like whenever I have the time. And it's also the more time you spend out of game, the less time you have making money in the game, flexing your accounts. If you run multiple accounts, you know, not everybody has the option to pay for their accounts with real life money. I would love to hear all of your thoughts about that. Who would like to go first, I guess?
Well, I've given some thought to that over the years, but they do have, CCP does have a fan site program. Which, you know, if you're a registered fan community website, then CCP will pay for one of your subscriptions for one character, and I know a lot of people participate in that. The only thing I have a question I have is if you try to expand that, how does that get policed, and you monitor that? You know, if somebody says, say Steve here, who is a stand-up guy, but, you know, he says he's developing third-party applications, but we're not watching Steve, so how are we supposed to know if he's really doing that or not, you know? And whose responsibility is that going to be to monitor that and to check up on it, I guess?
Yeah, that's always, unfortunately, one of the problems. There's manpower requirements here. There is a fan site program. It can take quite a long time to get someone into it, just because of the amount of work that's required on the back end to keep track of, are these sites still active, which sites are actually on the fan site program, and so on. There was a change about a year ago, I believe, might be 2 years now, where it's now possible to get, instead of just getting the, here is your account, it's free, you can get it as 12 plex instead, 1 plex per month. It's not a, here's 12 plex, it's 1 plex per month.
Right.
Which is potentially beneficial for some people who really, they want to pay for their accounts anyway, but they want to be able to do things like give Plex away and so on.
Right.
So there's options. But yeah, it's a bunch of work required on CCP's side, and the community team can at times appear to be just a touch overworked.
Yeah, I think pretty much it just comes down to Falcon every year, going through all the websites and making sure they're still active, you know. But it's a lot of work for a very small crew of people.
Yeah.
Lockfox, do you have any thoughts about this?
Well, so part of it, it is nice having the recognition from the official, to be officially sanctioned and all that. And it really does mean a lot once you cross that threshold. But as you said, the actual return, like if that's your money-making scheme or your break-even point, like you're doing a lot more work, you're pay per hour really sucks for that. when it comes to my side, so seeing as I'm more of a news operator, I get slightly frustrated in the fact that like the Plex split, for instance, this week, it comes, it hits, and then I need to go make the rounds and hit all the podcasts and talk to all the people about it. Like, my phone didn't stop buzzing on Thursday and most of Friday, talking about the Plex split. And I do enjoy talking about it, but like, I get bombed on it and I would love some head warning. I understand that like getting randos read in for a NDA and leaks and all that is probably not worth it. But like, that's where I come from in my frustration of, I don't mind doing it in and of itself. I enjoy the community building. I do it. I do the streaming and everything for me. All of this content work is done because I love to do it. But it's mildly frustrating trying to be a professional adult and then having the schedules flipped over so hard without any warning. So that's really my only personal gripe.
Yeah, I would personally love to see a more engaging role for content creators. Like, for example, if you take Wingspan, for example, Chance Ravine, he's got a huge marketing background, and what he does for his corporation in terms of advertisement, the presentation that he does with his, you know, with his website, and his Reddit things, and it's always on the top of the list, and he has a very large understanding of marketing. And you know, if CCP would just work with him, like, how can Chance Ravine help CCP, or the other way around? And I would love to see more involvement in that. Like, you know, I make YouTube videos as well, and I don't even get close to some of the YouTubers out there, but I do spend a lot of time editing and stuff like that. And to get some recognition from CCP, or maybe CCP helping me to get my content out as well, would be, you know, hugely beneficial, and that would motivate me even more. Like, LogFox, you are a big economic guy, and you have a lot of understanding on how the market works, and maybe CCP could, you know, approach you, or you can approach them, and you know, you guys can work together to get a bigger, broader, you know, platform or something like that. Or you know, you hardly see CCP posting third-party content on their news website, for example, but you know, you know that would help content creators a lot if your name is on the login screen, for example, or something like that. That would be great.
Well, so I kind of disagree a little bit in that. So brand building is its own topic, and we could probably talk an hour about it. I kind of enjoy doing it, but I'm a bit of a sicko. It's that it does require that you build the community, not just internally for your viewers, but also externally to the people who can help echo your message and help get you the extra coverage. And at least in my case, CCP has been extraordinarily helpful in that, like, CCP Quant has been easy to get a hold of, and I can't tell you how many times he's saved my bacon from an R problem, but that's because he and I share that interest, and really we'd be sharing that same stuff whether I was producing the show or not. And the community team with Guard and Mimic has been kind enough to grant me the space to do the segments on the 07 show, which are a huge boom for the Prosper audience. But it ends up being two sides of it. Is one, you know, you get the extra exposure inside the community, but there is sort of a critical mass depending on how you've set things up. Like, Hyde and Chance can garner much, and Johnny Pugh can garner much larger audiences because their content is much more digestible. It's much more pop. It would, I guess, be the easiest way to say it. Whereas, you know, Prosper is a niche show for a niche audience on a niche game. Like, there are numbers in my head of our absolute maximums, and they're like, I don't think we'll ever get above 5,000 YouTube subs, for instance, not without leaving Eve, or not without completely changing the way we do things and adding more pop content, which is fine. This is fine. Like, I understand my spot in the metasphere. I'm happy to do it. I enjoy talking with our audience. The things I get out of it are the Patreon support to help us keep the server hardware running, and the community that I can go to talk about the news with them and get feedback on stuff that we're developing, and really build up that economic sort of centerpiece, you know, between Prosper and the SCC Lounge gives us two great footholds for people to shitpost about the market, if I may say.
Yeah, or add girls in bikinis to the show, Locke.
Man, if I start doing strips, like, you're going to have to pay me to put my clothes back on. I'm an ugly motherfucker.
Steve, you have any thoughts about that? Not about the bikini thing, though.
Aw.
Yeah, can we shave your beard for Plex?
Yeah, I'm still trying to decide if I'm going to shave if I don't win the election. But I can't say anything for that now. I haven't decided. Yeah, as I mentioned before, CCP's community team have a great deal of work, not just sitting around twiddling their thumbs all day. So it always is troublesome trying to get more support out of them for people. To a degree, you've got to hit a critical mass yourself before it's really worth the return for them to help you, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Well, they've scaled back on the amount of I don't know how to put this nicely, but I mean, they've scaled back their community efforts as well over the last year. So, you know, there's just less resources now than ever.
Yeah, I've been trying to get a hold of CCP Logi Bro because I think he's the fan side guy to talk to. And
yep, he is.
I'm just not getting any response, and then I poke CCP Lilu to poke him at the office to get back to me, and then I hear nothing back, and CCP Lilu is just kind enough to poke him, but, you know, just nothing happens, and I'm like, you know, hey guys, you know, I'm spending hours and hours of my free time to create content. I would just like to know what's up, but, you know, can you help me out? Can you maybe advise me on how to get a bigger audience? You know, I make like small PvP videos and try to, you know, show what I do, and then try to teach others how to do it, or maybe give out some tips and tricks and stuff like that. And I think that that's hugely beneficial to the community, especially to newer players. I mean, I do get a lot of feedback from players that they find it useful and stuff like that, but I would just like to, you know, get my stuff out there, and CCP has not been really helpful in that regard, and I would just like to see them do that for other content creators as well. Like, you know, there are a lot of YouTube creators out there who, if you look at their sub numbers, it's just, you know, it's horrible, and they do, you know, they have a lot of great videos. It's just, you know, when you see the numbers, you're like, you tend to get demotivated by it. You know, you're not reaching the audiences that you want to reach.
There's a couple of things that are at play here, and I'm sure Locke and Steve will back me up on these. And it's hard to quantify all of it, but, you know, don't be discouraged, first of all, because, you know, even, and I'm sure Locke and Steve can answer this too, it takes a lot, it takes time, and it takes consistency, and it takes some effort to build up that audience. I mean, you know, just from my standpoint, it took 5 years of me trying, sort of trial and error, finding a niche where they would, that I finally broke through and CCP would start paying attention to some of the work that I was doing and start talking to me as a, as an artist and an illustrator. And finally, you know, after, you know, basically beating my head against the wall for 5 years over why isn't the store better? Why don't we have these things? Why, you know, why is all this going on? And finally realized that it wasn't about necessarily, you know, setting things on fire all the time. It was about finding the right way to get through that wall and then get attention that way. And it succeeded. And, you know, it, for a little while anyway, and now they're back to being, you know, closed door off a little bit about it, but that's just because of the fallout of certain things that didn't work out, I think, and some scaling back that they've done and the launch of a new store, which we can, you know, complain about all we want, but that, so that's one thing. So it's really consistency and time and effort. And it just takes that, you know, not giving up and keeping at it and finding your audience. Because one of the things, you know, you said it yourself, there's a lot of videos out there and not all of them are getting a lot of views. And that's because not that they're not quality, it's just that a lot of them look the same. A lot of them there's a lot of content that is kind of the same. And, you know, the guys that you mentioned who, Reload, Corin Marr, who's doing those nice 3D animation things. You know, the people you mentioned who are getting attention, if you think about the videos that they're doing, there's something different about each of them. You know, it's something different about the Zekiel guide to the ships that Reload's doing. It's not the same. There's nobody else doing that. And so it's finding that, you know, what's your voice and how best do you get to communicate it? And that's how you stand out above the crowd.
Yeah, it's also, you know, I love the Wingspan videos myself. I love to see somebody else do what I do as well. And then, you know, but, you know, for some reason he does it completely different, but he's still on screen. He does the same things. He just does it, you know, his voice or maybe, you know, his editing skills are completely different. And, you know, I don't know, and I just can't pinpoint what it is exactly, and that goes for all of these different content creators. It's like so hard to pin down what the EVE community is gonna like because it's such a diverse community. Like I noticed that my videos are liked best by newer players, players who just get into PvP or are trying wormholes for the first time or do a lot of day tripping, and that's when, you know, they learn about my tips and tricks and stuff like that. So, you know, I definitely cater to that side of the community. Yeah, I definitely know that my videos don't, you know, are not necessarily interesting for like the higher class wormhole guys. They are like, you know, what the hell is this? You know, we get fights like this every day, or, you know, this is nothing new to us. So they click it away, you know. So it's definitely focus where you wanna where you wanna aim at. And but that's hard, man. That's not an easy thing to do because it's very hard to recognize your own strengths and weaknesses and what it is that makes, you know, for example, me interesting to listen to, or to watch, or whatever. So that's very, very hard to identify for me at least.
No, it is for everybody. I think it's one of the most challenging parts of it. Really, is trying to, but it's maturing as an artist and as a communicator, and, you know, understanding what it is your message, what you want your message to be, and then who that who your audience might be, and then how best to go about talking to them and grabbing their attention. And I think that's the challenge that all of us face as communicators, because that's really what it comes down to, what we're doing, and finding the right way to communicate the message that we're trying to. It's really difficult.
Yeah.
Well, and none of us get famous overnight. Like, I've been writing the Eve Prosper blog for over 5 years, almost six at this point, though I don't know if you want to count the last year as blogging, because I really haven't done a whole ton of it. And like, I went and did a stint with writing for TMC, now INN, and I've been doing the Prosper show for 2 years, but like, it took us a lot of effort to get over some humps and get publicized and build the community and get out there. And I didn't get there by myself. I mean, thanks to you know, making a personal brand and doing the Hydrostatic show got people to come cross over to Prosper. For building up the Tweetfleet Slack servers is another place that we were able to capture a lot of the economic people interested in economic topics, because we were there at the right space at the right time to pick up people. And it's a matter of this is why I speak so much about the passion for doing it for yourself, because the success takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of determination, and you have to do it despite the numbers. And that's the only way you're ever going to get to the numbers. And even now, I still get surprised by some of our growth. That so we take a summer hiatus, and I was expecting to just sort of stay flat. I thought we basically plateaued at the end of last year, and coming into this last fall, that we were going to see, you know, we were going to stay in that 2,200 YouTube subs, and maybe still keep getting the, if we were on a good week, 30 people live, and that sort of thing. But thanks to coming back, having good content to talk about, and tying in with the 07 show, we've seen incredible growth in our live talks, in our activity on our chat channels. And as much as I keep wanting to sit here and go, well, I don't know if I keep wanting to do this, because I've got, you know, I have some professional, personal projects I'd rather be working on with the time. Like, I'd like to transition to a more Python Dev Fleet style show instead of a Eve economic show. But I have a hard time leaving my audience behind when they are so enthusiastic and so generous and so high quality, and there's no one else taking up my mantle. The only other person, there's only a couple other people broadcasting in my meta, and that's Delone Wolf, who the reason Prosper's around is because I watched Delone Wolf's show and I'm like, nah, I want it. That's not the show I want. And so I made the show I wanted. I love his work. I think he does a great job. I have no hate for the guy. He's amazing. We just look at the problems differently. And there's a couple of people starting to come up in the sort of day trading, finding their voices thing. But it's the brand building takes time, effort, dedication, and you do it. It's just like when you go work out and you don't want to go to the gym on the bad days. Those are the days you have to go in. Like, those are the most important days to go in, or the days you don't want to go to the gym. It's a totally similar thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. You know, having stuff to talk about is sometimes, you know, Eve has these ups and downs. Like, if you'd ask me like 3 weeks ago, you know, to do a new show or like a new episode from a show, I would be like, yep, but what am I going to talk about? There's, you know, I can, you know, I've been wanting to get Rix on for like ages to talk about his content and stuff, but I can't fill an entire show just with that. I mean, I need something else. And then, you know, some drama started to happen. And then this week, CCP, you know, came out with this big Plex announcement. I was like, okay, now I can, you know, create a show with different guests and have a couple of subjects to talk about that can link together and you know.
Yeah, or you could do what I do sometimes, which is when there's nothing else going on, then I just make up some.
yeah. You know,
I don't care what the rest of the internet says. That Mitanni video was hilarious.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, I love that video. Like, that was hilarious.
I think it's funny that people, you know, for what they think that I care one way or the other what he thinks about me, which I don't. And then secondly, that something like that he would come out and do, and then I would just leave it alone. I think it's pretty hilarious that people expect me to just not do anything with it. It's pretty funny. So, yeah, of course I did.
Yeah, like you created the bridge. So let's.
It was like Christmas, you know.
I've been wanting to cover the drama subject in a general sense a little bit more. Because I've talked to CCP Guard in my last episode, and then I popped the question like, are you guys seeing more extremes over the years in terms of insults, actions against players, stuff like that? And he said, well, it's not necessarily getting more, but you know, then you know, right after that interview, like two or three incidents happened where people get called at work, people get called on their cell phone, stuff like that. Happened to me as well a couple of months back. You know, people get threatened in real life. You know, Rick's wife got involved, like stuff like that. And then, you know, I'm thinking, didn't I ask Guard about this a couple of days ago? And it seems like things like this get more extreme, or that what used to be extreme are now basically the new standard. I guess doxing is like a very popular thing nowadays. Like people call each other up, and I mean, what the hell's going on, guys? Like,
so I was for a while on the ball of like, man, I don't understand. Like my stuff never crossed over too bad into the drama spheres. Even when I wrote at TMC, and even when I wrote a piece that was basically shaming the Imperium at the time for running a Ponzi scheme on their own members, I barely got any, like, I got almost no shit posting for it, and I was a little disappointed. I'm like, well, maybe my stuff is just too cerebral, or maybe I'm just not entertaining enough, and I don't put enough bait out there for people to argue about. Like, I just don't get clickbait journalism. And lately, oh my god, I've been having more and more trouble in the Prosper YouTube channel. That one of my episodes, I ended up getting like a dozen comments where everyone was mansplaining to me about how to do presentation correctly. And I'm like, I'm almost 90 episodes in. I think I know what the fuck I'm doing, and I'm not going to change.
That's very bizarre.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, yeah.
It was weird. There was a lot of them, and it was all in one episode. We got, I mean, I love the throughput we got on there, but I think I got on somebody's cringe compilation or something. And then this last week, episode 88, I had somebody, because I do a pre and a post show on the live show, and I don't shy away from political subjects, but I'm usually in a calling out bullshit from a data perspective kind of guy, like not really a partisan, more of a data science guy. And somebody decided to go all herf derf on what I was saying. I mean, I deleted the stuff because I'm not leaving shit on my wall for that, you know. But it has been getting worse, and it's been really hard to tell if that's because I'm reaching a new plateau of growth, and I just now I'm in front of enough eyes that the shit quotient is finally kicking in. If it's that the new alphas mean that we have a lower class of players in the game now, where people are being shitty internet teenagers, or if this is a Trump's America thing where now it's okay to be a shitheel 4chaner, I can't figure it out.
I think it's definitely you're hitting a bigger audience all of a sudden. You've crossed a threshold sort of thing. Like, where I used to get comments like, hey, man, I love your video, but, you know, your audio is a little bit high or a little bit low, or, you know, could you do this a little bit better or that? And then that transitioned into, you know, oh my God, at 6 minutes and 43 seconds, I heard a bird in the background and totally ruined the experience for me. Like, what?
Well, and what? And so what? Like, and there's, yeah, there's a group of people too, that come in and try to, like, whatever, and I've been doing the show long enough that I know what I can change and what I can't. And there's some of it's like, you know what? If you're really that mad, go make your own show. I will be happy. I will even link it on my own. I enjoy actually expanding my space because I think that the economic, industrial meta of the game is getting really underserved at the moment. A lot of big blogs have closed, and so I'm more than happy to even give you guys the shout outs to compete against me. But like, oh my god, one of the things I can't get some people to understand is that the shorter the show is, the more work it is to produce. That doing the 45 minute show that we do now every week takes a little over 2 hours on air because we do it live, and an hour off air to run code. And that's not even doing any new development. That's just regular pressing buttons, making the show. To make the 07 report, which is a 3 minute report, takes me almost 3 hours from writing the report and plus maybe 1 hour if I have to make a new graph, and producing it, cutting it up, getting it encoded and pushed out. It takes 3 hours to make 3 minutes of content. And yeah, this idea that like I need to be the Jim Cramer of Eve and come in every week with 15 minutes of buy this, sell that, like completely belays the incredible amount of labor. Like my tool quality would have to be two classes higher than it is now because I just can't freaking do it. And I'd have to be ready to do 3 hours of work every day that I did this show. And I can't, I won't. Not enough audience in the game to get there. If I could get over like 50,000 subs and do that, or if this was big enough that I could go run a competing service to Crossing Zebras and INN, which was industry and data science focused, do like a 528 of Eve, then yeah, sure, I like great, because then there'd be enough audience to support that kind of work. But like, no, now what you want me to, so for 10% more subs, spend three times more effort than I'm doing right now? You've got to be kidding me. I have a job, for fuck's sake.
Well, you know, for me, sometimes, you know, I make a video and it's, you know, straightforward. I ganked a Drake in a combat site, killed it, made a video about it, gave some fast tips and tricks, nothing special. And then somebody comes along and then, you know, posts like, oh my god, that was a shit video, the Drake couldn't even fight back, he was outnumbered, blah blah blah, you suck, go die in a fire. I'm like, dude, first of all, you totally misunderstood like what I was trying to, you know, teach other players. Like, apparently you're not the type of guy that I wanna, you know, make videos for. But maybe you could, you know, stop the shit posting and just appreciate that there's somebody out there creating content. That for me would be like ideal circumstance, I guess. That's what, you know, kinda sometimes demotivates me from making content. It's like, oh my god. You know, I'm yeah. You know, that's the thing, and that's what comes back to the CCP involvement, I guess. It's like, CCP could maybe, you know, hey guys, check out this awesome video, and then, you know, I don't know, sometimes
it's, I just say, just don't let it, you can't let it bother you. You have to let most of the criticism go in one ear and out the other, because it can't knock you off of your path. What it can do, though, is help guide you to make it better, if it's legit or not. I mean, you know, I was just sitting here looking, you were talking about, you know, viewers and comments and things. The Eve Dumb Ways to Die video that I did with Sindel, it's 3 years old. It's over 610,000 views now. And even just yesterday, I got a comment on it that said, this sucks. You know, it's 3 years old. It has 610,000 views. And just yesterday, somebody watched it, probably for the first time, and felt compelled to comment on it and say, this sucks. I mean,
well, and, so, and, you know. And if I And if I can go sell a message to the general public here, that like the content creators out there, most of us are doing it for pittances if we're getting anything. A lot of it, like, I wrote the blog for free for years. I got, you know, maybe 500 million isk during my tenure at TMC. Like, we're talking peanuts, the scrap shells around peanuts kind of pay yeah. here. And so, like, I had this rant on my show, not this last week, but the week before, that, like, if you want good media, you have to pay for it. And I don't mean that in a dot. Well, a little bit of that is dollars and cents, but most of it is there's a lot of ways to support the content you enjoy. And when it came to real life media, like all of this boo CNN biased media, alternative facts bullshit, like clickbait, if you want free news, clickbait is the sort of content you're going to get, because you're going to get what you pay for, because in-depth journalism just does not generate clicks the way that kittens and rage does. So that, you know, this is why we're here IRL. But getting down at the Eve sphere, like, you have no idea how much it means to me when I get direct comments that I have helped someone in some way. Like, I got a direct mail shortly after I started the show. It had to be 3 or 4 months in, maybe 6 months in. And the guy had said he had had a stroke and was recovering. And he was having a hard time with all of the work he had to do to get back to normal, and how much trouble he was having just talking. Like, he had developed a major stutter, and it was really embarrassing for him. And the fact that when I do the show, a lot of the times I'll be sitting there on a roll, because the show is largely improv, and I'll come to a dead stop going, I had a point, I don't remember what it is, words, and we'll stop for maybe a whole minute while I try to get back on the horse. And he sent me a letter that said, you know, that meant a lot to me, because I stopped feeling like a freak. Like, I felt like a normal person, because I knew that you had the same problem I did. And it was the most important mail I've ever received doing the show. And stuff like that is incredibly powerful for the creators you love. And that's doing awesome. and even not going that far. Like, I know that if I only get one of those, I will have count. I can count myself blessed more than I deserve. But there are so many places where you can stand up and be like, I enjoy your show, or I retweet your tweets, or I join your chats, or I emailed you, I emailed you that I really enjoyed that last show. You guys are doing a good job. Or, hey, you know, I ganked this guy, and here's an extra 200 million isk that I had laying around because I wanted to support you. Like, the tiny gestures of support outweigh tenfold the bullshit that anybody gets. And
oh, yeah.
Meaningful comments about, like, I liked this, but did you think about blank? I do love getting all that. That's why we have the Discord channel we have. It's why we've been so active on the Tweetfleet Slack. Is that I am just the mouthpiece for the group. Like, I just am a graph reader at this point, and I've been out of the game in a meaningful sense for so long that, like, you'll know my weakness when I go do the violence report at the end of the show every week, and I'm like, well, it looks like so-and-so was fighting it. Like, there's a big fight in Nullsec. No idea who owns that space. Anyway, thanks for tuning in.
yep.
And the Twitch chat will be like, oh, that was Brave versus PL. They were having a slap fight and whatever. And like, it's because of the community I have any hope of even staying, have the least chance of even being relevant. And so I got to thank everybody who tunes in. It does really mean a lot. It's not just a script. And the positive support outweighs the negative tenfold. So if you enjoy a show,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
And if it's this show, if it's my show, if it's the work that Steve does, just sending a thumbs up, hey, you rock, even something that simple, really means a lot.
Yep, definitely.
Yep, amen. Yep.
Yeah, well, you know, we got Rick Javix here, and I asked him to make me like these trading cards for your character. That meant so much to me. Like, I don't know, just a silly gesture of making a card like that. That meant so much to me, because that meant that in Rix's eyes, I've earned that card. Like, and you know, that was one of the moments that I was like, okay, well, you know, I'm obviously doing something right, because you know, not everybody gets a card like that made by Rix Javix. And you know, I was so proud of that, and all my friends were like, oh my god, I want one too, you know, can you ask, like, I want one, can he make one for me, like, that's awesome. that made me real feel, you know, proud, like, it's such an awesome card, man, like.
Oh, great, I'm glad to hear that, thanks, yeah, that's awesome.
You know, I want to transition into the latest news.
Just one thing before we do.
Yeah,
if you are wanting a signal boost on your own stuff, just to get out there, you can always try emailing share. I think it's share@eveonline.com. It won't necessarily get you a signal boost, and I wouldn't suggest spamming them with everything you do. But if you've got something that's definitely special, it's seriously worth sending a mail there, because you might get something going out on Twitter or Facebook or something like that. And probably I'm going to get angry comments about advertising that address.
No, that's a good idea, though. It is a good suggestion.
I, you know, let me get a list of the platforms that I post my content to. It's Twitter, it's Facebook, it's YouTube, obviously. It's the EVE Online forums, the EVE University forums. Then I got my Alliance Slack, because I'm also in a NullSec Alliance. So I post there. I post on Discord. It's like a lot of channels. And I do notice that, you know, ever since I joined the Facebook group, that does help a lot. It's just very hard to, you know, a lot of people are just not active on those platforms. Like, a lot of people just log in and play the game, and I guess the official news channel is the only channel that reaches them, I guess.
That's the kind of thing that the share address can do,
yeah,
because it's official. The main benefit is it's a boost, and the downside is CCP cannot see everything that everyone does, because there is a lot of content out there, so they won't boost everything. It's just getting it in front of the eyes of the people who might see it.
Yeah, that's the other side too. Well, I think we touched on it a little bit, but you know, just in the last 3 years, say, or 2 years, the magnitude of content, the expansion, the explosion of content that's been coming out of the community is just, I mean, it's insane how much every day there's, you know, so much being produced.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, definitely Twitch. YouTube has grown a lot. You know, a lot of YouTubers out there right now, solo PvP, low-sec PvP, even the Wormhaulers and the Nullseckers are making these awesome videos.
Yeah, just, streamers too.
Yeah, but, you know, most of the videos don't get a lot of views, and I don't know, I don't know what are large numbers for YouTube video regarding EVE Online. I've heard that I'm not doing that bad, but I just don't know. But when you look at Johnny Pugh, you know, he sometimes has 9,000 views, and I'm like, wow, that's amazing.
Well, setting, let's say. So we're almost 100 episodes in, and we've only recently been able to get more than 50 regularly on our live streams. That goes way up when we get featured somewhere, like when we get a signal boost from Eve News 24 this last week. We were up over 100. When we were doing hydrostatic content, we could get 200, but that was a better time zone for that. And the YouTube generates, so we have just shy of 3,000 as of this recording, subs, and I think we get somewhere in the 1,100 views per show, just to sort of put numbers to things. And it's been an exponential curve, though. So just 6 months ago, you could cut those numbers in half. So we've been on a really big growth spurt, thanks to the Alpha Clones and just how long we've been doing it and really getting the stride so that the show is like really in its, you know, you come to the show and it's the same every week. So, but it's taken over 2 years, 2.5 at this point, to get to where we are just on that.
Yeah, yeah. Let's transition into the latest CCP announcement regarding Plex, and I would like to start off with Steve and ask him what is the thought process that CCP gave you that made them make this decision, because that's not 100% clear to me right now. And let me explain that first. It's like the system, the way it works right now, has never been sort of like an issue for me, understanding how it works and stuff like that. And it never even, occurred to me that it might be even like a really, elaborate way of converting different currencies into one currency or something like that. I never really saw it like that. But how did CCP approach the CSM, and what was their thought process, and what made them decide to make this move?
It really all comes down to making life easier for players. With multiple currencies, that being Plex, ISK, and Orvum, how do you convert from Plex to ISK? You've got to sell it directly. Okay, fine. How do you convert from Orum to ISK? You can't directly. You've got to buy a good and then hope that that sells appropriately. So when you've got a little Orum sitting, like 1,000, it's not actually that easy to go, I just sell it to someone else. Moving everything over to just being ISK and Plex makes that a lot easier. The cognitive load for it is significantly reduced. I've seen on occasion people commenting that they don't want to spend all the money and get a Plex, but they want to get some real money and just convert it into ISK. They were unfortunately thinking, I'll buy some Orvum, get an Orvum token and sell that, not realizing at the time that you couldn't actually do that. So they were set straight on that and bought something and sold it. But that is a pain in the ass to manage for a new player. Even for an old player, it's, what's the best conversion rate? I have no clue. I would have to go and dig through the store, get all the items from the store, get all the prices for current stuff, and then go, this is what I should get. It just evens all of that out.
Well, and this is why we don't track the skins market on Prosper, is that whole what's the best dollar to ISK rate was too confusing, and I just wanted to funnel people into Plex.
I never thought of it that way. That was a good explanation, Steve.
What was the CSM reaction to this change? Was there, a universal, oh my god, yes, finally? Or were there, mixed reactions?
I don't like speaking for other people on the CSM. In general, the reaction was fairly positive. Because, well, it kind of just makes sense when you look at it as a replacement for Orvum. Something a lot of people seem to be missing is that it is a replacement for Orvum. They're just going, why do they want to split Plex into 500? That makes no sense. It makes sense if you consider that it's a replacement for Orvum.
I'm so glad to see Orvum going away. I've hated it for so long.
Yeah,
I love the change. I think it's great.
Yeah, I fully support it too. I think, I don't even, I sat through it last night and listened with Locke trying to explain it too, but I don't see a problem with it at all. I have no reason to use Aurum, and really bumped into it. It's kind of silly to think that we have multiple currencies in one universe. We should only have one, really. So I'm all for it.
The way I understand it right now is that it's gonna one plex is gonna be 500 plex units when they introduce the change. That's correct, right?
Yes.
Does that also mean that you can now sub your account for like a week instead of a
no,
month?
No, it doesn't. So it's still 30 days basis. Only.
Okay.
Yeah, but... Ryze was covering that on Talking in Stations this morning. So far the splitting that up is really painful, not from a development side on making things happen in game, but more on a customer service side.
Yeah,
it makes sense.
Yeah, and then when your account runs out of Plex, it's still active, so I guess. But also the multiple character training is also going to be 30 days, and all that.
I didn't actually check, but I would assume so. Yeah,
it makes sense.
Lockfox, you made a bold prediction about the prices of Plex in the future. I think you mentioned 2 billion at the end of the year.
Let me cut the sensationalism a little bit, because my prediction is complicated. One, in the short term, once this releases, so let's say we're targeting a June release for the big post FanFest release, right? I still expect from everything I've been seeing in the monthly economic numbers that Plex should trend down. It's not down right now. We're in a bit of a shortage. It's complicated. If you really want to build castles out of tinfoil, you can say that it's CCP leaks, but it's probably just Rorqual pilots crashing out their heads now that the Rorqs got nerfed. And you can thank Rivra for that analysis. In the long term, what I think this does is that it opens up the market to a lot more people to participate. Plex is the largest market in EVE. It counts for like 50% of the share of trades in JITA is in Plex. And it's really hard to jump in that market when you're talking about a billion ISK a slice, like just to be able to participate. Like either you're buying, selling onesie twosie, or you're talking about hundreds of billions of ISK floating through rotation. By splitting it, that brings the cost per item down, and it means a lot more people can participate in the market at 2 million rather than at 1 billion. The second thing is that I think we're going to be able to see more of a boiled frog effect, because with the prices as low as they are, the thought of, well, what's the difference between a 2 million mini-plex and a 3 million mini-plex? Like, who cares? A 3 million mini-plex is a bill and a half for game time. And I think that this opens the door to finally get above the 1.4 record level that we were at. The actual peaks and when we hit them is a lot harder to do without knowing the roadmap for the next 6 months, without knowing what the hype from EVE Vegas will be. We tend to peak out in the fall, so we could hit 2 billion. I don't know if we would in 2017, but it leaves a lot more room for the cost per month to sway a lot harder than it has in the past. So we could see much cheaper Omega status, and we could see much more expensive Omega status. We may not be stuck at the 1 billion sort of expectation that we've been at for 18 months.
One side effect of breaking the Plex up is, as long as CCP stay with what they're doing with Aurum at the moment and offering smallish packs, like I believe you can buy a 900 pack at the moment, if you can buy a similar kind of size of pack, that could actually count as a supply increase, because, well, I want to throw $5 at EVE. Okay, done. rather than going, if I want to throw money at Eve, I pretty much have to throw it in $20 packs. That's quite a significant difference just from the way people think.
Now that I got both of you on, I've been dying to ask somebody, where does the difference between a sub of $14.95, I believe, and a $20 Plex come from? Where there's a $5 difference, which is quite a lot. Where does that difference come from?
I don't know the history specifically. I just figured they... Well, I mean, I know the history comes from the game Timecode market, which I don't know exact... That goes way, way back, and I'm not sure what the original markup was for, but why take less money if you don't have to? I guess it'd be the way... Why it stayed as high as it has. But Plex is so often on sale that... Buying, like, okay, this is probably me being a little classist that, yeah, one might be $20, but if you're paying in like $100 at a time, the rate has been pretty decent and pretty average over the last couple of years. I've always been an advocate of getting it closer to parity, but it is an opportunity for CCP to get an extra couple percentage points. And remember that when you buy game time, that's not accounted in the books the same way that Plex is accounted for. Plex counts as credit until you consume it. So of that Plex that's just sitting around in hangars is liability on CCP's books. So from an accounting standpoint, I can see why you'd want to try and not screw yourself for doing that.
Basically what he said.
I've read a few Reddit posts regarding leaks. Is there a definite story behind this, or is it like Lockfox said, Oracle aftermath sort of thing?
I'm pretty much going with it's tinfoil. If anyone has any proof or anything along those lines, then you should contact CCP at their Infernal Affairs email, but I've not seen any evidence any which says yes.
Yeah, I have a really hard time getting on the CSM leak train, and again, I know that Steve here has NDAs to stand behind, so I'll see if I can take a little bit of the heat off, and that the CSM should have been as a player, you should be expecting that the CSM has heard about what the change is, but the particular Plex spike that looks so ominous would require some real know-how about when, because like we're talking about 36 hours before the dev blog went out, which means that the dev blog was already in the publishing queue at CCP. And if that's the case, then really the only place to get a leak from is maybe the community team. So like we're talking a T20 scandal if that's the case. And it's just that level of conspiracy is just redonkulous. And we were already in sort of a shortage supply because the Plex market has been a little weak on supply for the last few weeks. It's been very quiet with as stable as the prices have been. We've seen less people bringing fresh Plex into the market. We've been seeing a lot of it just sort of get the old stocks get pushed out of the system, essentially. And the fact that we came in with a weak supply and then Rorqual pilots liquidating their brains requires a lot of Plex to get the extractors. Like, you just buy out the market, and whenever the market goes to zero, it's a divide by zero problem where the price goes through the freaking roof. So I like Reaver's explanation a lot better, because the amount of tinfoil you have to get in your diet to make it a leak means that, like, somebody with a lot of seniority at CCP leaked it for not a lot of money. It's rather preposterous.
So, is there you know, an estimation on when this change is gonna occur, or is that a FanFest announcement, or is there no definite answer?
There is no definite answer on when this will happen.
Yeah, Rise said on Talking in Stations this morning that they're aiming for soon trademark, and he'd be disappointed if it wasn't out by June. But that's really the best I've heard, and I would really expect something at FanFest about it.
Well, that's pretty soon, June. I mean, that's not far away. So yeah, I think we've covered the subject. I mean, I don't really have any questions regarding it myself. Like I think it's a good thing. Like, one currency, awesome. Like in real life, I live in Europe, so everything's in euros, and there was a great uproar about that, and in the end, it made life so much easier just to have one currency in the surrounding countries, and you know, when you buy stuff online, it's just a lot easier. So I'm okay with it. You know, just on a side note, if Lex is gonna hit 2 billion. Is that ever gonna happen? Like, I might have to unsub a few accounts because my wife's gonna kill me if I pay for all my accounts. Like, I don't really, you know, if I would go to my wife and say, hey, I want to buy some blacks and in large chunks, she'd kill me on the spot. So, you know, I Plex my account, so I don't have a lot of trouble making money right now. It's just I don't like to do it. Like, it's the most boring thing ever, making money in EVE. And so if that means I have to make twice as much to keep an account running, that might cause me to unsub. So I think it might be in the best interest of CCP to maybe not let that happen.
I hate to be the fake economist, but I disagree with you, and I'm sorry.
Okay, explain why.
Okay, so and it gets really complicated, and you should really tune into EVE Prosper if you want to hear the whole rigmarole about it. So Plex is a cash sponge. At the end of the day, Plex, you can think about it more like gold, but gold isn't quite the right medium. What ends up happening is that when we see an imbalance in fountains, what will happen is that money will run into Plex. So we saw that from casinos, we've seen that from ratting, we've seen that from incursions. When it's easy to generate cash will be sopped away in Plex. And then when cash is tight, when I need cash to squeeze out, I'll go to Plex to pull it out. And that's where we saw the big Plex crash last year about with the skill trading release, since everybody changed their positions from Plex into skill trading. And then same with Citadel, we saw a huge liquidity crunch between Citadel, World War B, and the skill trading, all coming on the backs of each other. This is why the prices went down so hard when Plex has historically like never fallen. Like, Plex, it was like the price of postage. You should always expect it to be higher the next time you need it. So I think that that's broken a lot of the more longer term wealth storage ideas. But to be honest, when I look out at the sort of CPI number where you say, what is the cost of playing EVE? What's the cost to get a miner together, or to fly a freighter, or to PvP at a given meta level? Those numbers stay incredibly flat over time, like outstandingly flat. And the only thing that really moves is Plex. And I'm personally excited to see Plex float a little freer, because I expect both higher highs and lower lows thanks to the change. And I think that will reflect the liquidity of players both in game and out of game in a much more organic way. Because right now it's kind of gathered too much magic, and we have, you know, sort of a We have all these ideas in our head about what the ceilings and floors are, and really the economy doesn't give a shit what your thoughts are about it. It's going to do what it's going to do. And so I think that liquidity going forward gives us the opportunity to move the Plex price down significantly in the next, let's say, 3 months with the way things are going, and gives CCP a place to go to say, well, I mean, are we removing cash from the game? And is that actually getting out? And is that getting is that being reported between the liquidity stats in the monthly economic report and the price of Plex together? I look at all three of those together to sort of set my health bar for the economy. So I think the price of Plex can be sustained at much higher levels than it has been, because I still think it's easy enough to generate the cash. And I think that there's reason enough for it to be much more expensive, given how much cash is going around. It's a similar argument that a lot of classical economists make, that like downtown parking in cities is too cheap. That why should you be able to park your car for $2 for 2 hours at prime time when somebody would be more than willing to put $50 down for that parking space if they were going to a concert? Like, that's sort of the expectation here, is that we've got used to a certain level of things, and I don't know if that's one-to-one reflected in the reality of liquidity in the game.
Wow, that's you know, half.
Sorry,
half.
I know it's a lot. This is why I try to keep it. I'm like, you want to hear it? Fine, I'll give you it, but I warned you.
you know, I'm always like, you know, I'm the average E player that doesn't really pay attention to all that inside information, and like I'm always thinking like, okay, this change affected that, and that change affected on top of that affected this, and I'm like, does CCP deliberately make these decisions right after another, or introduce changes right after another just to, you know, do they, you know, are they 100% aware of the effect that's going to have?
No, like, they do it on purpose. They purposely don't know all of the impacts. The point of the sandbox architecture is that to give the players interesting tools and then execute and then see what happens when all of the systems work together. Eve is an incredibly complex tapestry of interactions between players and economics and social structures and political structures. And though they should be expected to do some of the first order calculations, like I still get up Fozzie's grill about his mineral changes for like Omber, I think was one of the stupidest changes he's done, and the rebalance on high end ores I think was stupid as well, but he should have known better, but that's fine, you know, once it's out there, and that's the nature of the world at that point.
Yeah, you know, the Oracle change, has it come to a point where the Oracle change has now made the Oracle useless again?
No, the wailing about the death of the Oracle is far too soon. It's just that when the Rourke came out, and I said this at Vegas, was that the price of minerals is going to fall essentially by half. And it was going to, like, I was telling people that we could see half-priced supers by May. And I still think we are on that track, but I don't think people really understood just how much material was going to come out, how many people were going to change from a mining, a ratting ISK generation thing to a mining one. And frankly, I think that if the economic goal was to kill some of the liquidity out of the market, I think that it was actually a good change to make them as powerful as they were, because you go from a ISK printing operation into a ISK neutral one, and
yeah.
that I think is good for the economy. When we cross the 1 trillion, the 1 quadrillion liquid ISK mark back at the start of the year, I was really worried that we were going to end up in a weird runaway situation. And it turns out that because of the mining change, this was exactly the sort of thing that Eve needed to absorb a lot of the productivity. And we're still running very hot. Like, I don't think we're out of the woods yet. I think that there needs to be another place to sink a lot of cash, given how much is still being generated. But we're not in as dire straits as I originally thought, because like when the things were announced and where we were going, the system is running very hot at the moment, and you can have a hot balance system, but the more energy in a system, the faster things can go terribly wrong. And I still think that we're in that warning zone when I go look at the stats.
All right. Anybody else have any thoughts about this?
Nope. He's pretty much covered up.
Yep. I don't have to have any thoughts, because all I have to do is ask Locke.
Oh, Locke Fox for CSM.
Yeah. So I never have to think about the market or what the market forces are doing. So I just ask him. It's good to have him around, that's for sure.
Yeah. At the end of the day, for me personally, if I can flex my accounts and I can pay for two and then get one from CCP, and I'm happy. And I've accepted the fact that a Plex right now is 1 billion. I don't produce stuff, so the whole Oracle thing that just didn't really affect me, because I rarely lose ships, so I don't have to buy a lot of them. So
I do want to see more destruction. That's my only gripe with the way things are going, is that I'd like to see about 20% more PvP than we're seeing, especially with how much production we've seen over the last 2 months.
I agree with that.
It's funny that you
explode
more.
Because being a content creator, I put a lot of YouTube videos online and then get smack talk for, ganking people, oh man, you killed somebody that couldn't fight back. And I'm like, dude, it's destruction. It's good for the cycle in Eve. Like, it has to happen. Like, and then, you hear people talk about, we need more destruction in the game. And then as a content creator, I'm constantly doing that. And I get smack talk for, oh man, you're killing the wrong thing. Like, yeah, but, death is death. Like, doesn't really matter what it is for me. Like, maybe that goes into my next thing with Ricks is I've been dying to ask you. I think it was a while back when you posted something regarding Warpcore stabs. I mean, I would love to hear the story behind that. Like, what was going on there?
Well, it's been an irritant in my play for the last 6 years. And 2 years ago, when I went to, it's like this. It's sort of a thing that's really easy to complain about, but it has a lot of meaning in the game as far as the way PvP works inside of Eve. And I had this conversation when I was at FanFest a few years back with Master Plan and with Fozzy, and tried to explain exactly what I was talking about. Is I think there's a way that we could all be a little bit more intelligent about how we're engaging each other, and not just about Warpcore stabs, but also about how electronic countermeasures work, and about how points and disruptors work, and how basically all of the fine down in the nitty gritty 1v1. When it comes down to one ship versus another ship, or whether that's in a fleet or whether that's two pirates battling it out. But the Warpcore stabs sort of represent the worst of that, because it's really bad gameplay, in my opinion, and there's not a lot of counter to it, and it's very, very, it's poor for both sides. It's a bad decision for the player who's putting it on their ship, and it's a bad decision for the player who's trying to do something about that. And I would like to see, and it's sort of a legacy. We talk a lot about legacy code, but there's a lot of things in the game that are also left over from the old days. And Warpcore stabs happen to be one of the ones that irritate me the most, because it's just really bad gameplay. And I think there's opportunities to not necessarily get rid of any of the functionality of it, but just make it more intelligent and make it make better sense.
Well, I deal with worker stabs on a daily basis. Like, as a hunter,
sure.
Hunting things in wormhole space, and just let's emphasize that wormhole space, just like LoSEC and NullSEC, is, for me, is an arena that when you step into it, you open yourself up to PvP. And that invalidates you as a player to use the excuse, I was unable to fight back. That, for me, that means wormhole space, LoSEC, NullSEC. Because whenever you jump into those areas, you get a warning saying, hey, you might lose your ship here. You know, nobody's here to protect you.
Yeah.
So Signal Cartel's got to piss you off then.
I try not to gank Signal Cartel. Because of their attitude. I know for a fact that when I encounter a Signal Cartel member, they're not gonna gang up on me.
But it's kind of like ganking a Red Frog Sino outside of a station in LoSEC. We really try not to do that too, because those guys are doing a service for all of us, you know. So I think Signal Cartel sort of falls into that too, because they're, you know, they're plotting out the wormholes. And I just on Sunday I used Signal's map to find my way to Thera. So, you know, they do provide a useful service, so we try not to shoot them.
I do got to say, Signal Cartel is the only exception. I spent 6 weeks with them. Kind of got bored because I just have a PvP mindset and just feel at home. So, but you know, I got huge respect for their mentality and their, you know, they constantly have to, whenever they get attacked, like, always keep in mind, like, oh my god, how am I going to approach the situation? So for me, they are the only exception. But I specifically remember a gank way back when I was in Wingspan. I tried to gank somebody who was doing PI, and they had 4 warpcore stabs on their ship, and I just couldn't gank it because it was constantly warping away from me. So I refit up my ship with 2 scrams and 1 disruptor, and wasn't able to get away from me. Like, the amount of effort that I had to go through to kill that, and then it led up to a Tengu kill as well, because his buddy came to help him, and that led up to an awesome, amazing kill, and so that was good content. But I constantly run into these situations where, you know, people choose to be in a PvP environment, they choose to fly in -1.0 space. So for me, that's the lowest space that you can go to, and then I just, you know, it's so frustrating when you went into like a situation where you set something up, you're using all the tricks in the book to try and get somebody, and then you engage and they just warp off. Like, that is so frustrating from a hunter point of view. And I don't know. It's from a hunter, it's so frustrating. But from, you know, I ran data and relic sites in an Estero, and you know, then I come up with the idea, maybe I should just put some worker stabs on it, because, you know, that's my money making tune. Maybe it's not the best idea to have that ganked, and you know, so I don't know. It's like the AFK cloaking discussion. It's the same thing. Like, it's so hard to get a solid good idea about that. Like, I don't know, but it's just, you know, I guess the low situation. How is that Are people really flying?
I don't think it's all that difficult to think of solutions that make sense. Most people tend to use warp core staves as a measure of safety and for moving quantities of things, whether it's freighters or ships from one place to another. There's moving things, situations in which you would need to actually fit a warp core stab, where the penalties against combat aren't a consideration because your ship's not a combat ship, or it's not going to be used in a combat situation. So you're just moving a megathron from one place to another, say. And then the second part is in combat sites, in faction warfare plexes or on PI stations or, where anything, or POCOs or any other place inside of a wormhole or a LOSEC or a NULSEC or wherever. And so there's, obviously I've given this a lot of thought over the years. There's many, many ways to make that a more engaging choice. In your example, for example, one of the suggestions that we've come up with and other people have come up with over the years is that it's a use-based thing. It takes so much cap to actually use the warp core stab that it's only good for saving that person that one time. So they get away the first time, and then the next time you catch them in the same system, it's not going to work for them. So that adds a little bit more of an engagement type of games play to it that's not present now. So the idea that the module just works all the time, no matter what, there's no chance, there's no randomization, there's no effect other than the combat penalties is kind of an unbalanced approach to gameplay, I think. So there are solutions to it. Or we could just get rid of them altogether, which would be great for me. But I don't actually believe that. I just want them to be better. That's all. And that's true of everything in the game. I just want all of it to be better. So,
well,
that's just one of the things that just irritate me.
Well, if you take away warp core stabs, interdiction nullified chips have also been subjected to some controversy or just critique. I think, the whole immune to battle sort of thing is a thing that comes up a lot, especially from the PvPer perspective. It can be frustrating. I use a lot of bubble traps and stuff like that, so I don't really like interdiction nullified chips. But on the other hand, when I use them myself, it's kind of like, and I also use warp core stabs when I fly, large quantities of stuff from one system to another. Like, I don't know, but maybe that's because it's available to you anyways. Like, I would be open to using other means of transportation or protecting myself when warp core stabs weren't available. So,
I'm all with Rix's death to warp core stabs, and they give you cancer and make your peen smaller.
Which is scientifically proven, by the way.
I love all of that propaganda. It's some of my favorite.
Poster.
So to some of the people, that like posting in the features and ideas thing. I do want to put out the point that you can't force people to lose and you can't guarantee people to win. Like, this has been yep. I've been playing this game for like 11 years or something, and there's so many times where you get like the PvP pirate crowd together and they'll be like, yeah, there should be more miners out here so that we can just get our cheap kills and
pad our
kill boards. And I'm like, what kind of idiot miner would be there to just line up to be slaughtered? Like, what benefit are you going to give them? Like, well, they can have 10% more ore. Like, fuck you. Would you do it for 10% more ore?
No.
I want to kill them. Like, then you know what? You need to come up with better ideas that fill out the space. Like, I'm all for a lot of the pushes that put more people in LOSEC, for instance. I think it's my favorite place in EVE to live is LOSEC. And like, the faction warfare stuff is a lot of fun, but there's still a lot of space that just has nobody in it. And like, it just frustrates me to no end when it's like, well, you get rid of it or whatever, and you know, industrialists be damned, and I just want my free kills. I want easy mode for me, please. And I know nobody here is suggesting that. I just
no.
It's a personal frustration.
Nobody really wants it either. If they did have it, they would get bored and quit the game in a couple of weeks. You know.
Yeah. Yeah.
If they were ever given that, you know, easy mode, people don't really want it. Yeah, but you know, they cry about it all the time. But you know, another thing that's happened too since I had these conversations with them 2 years ago is a lot of the ships now. Well, some of the newer ships, you know, like the Venture, have warp core stabs built into them, which I am a huge fan of because that's part of the ship's character. And then on the other hand, they Fozzie came out with the Rick ship, the Mollus Navy issue, which he made for me, so I could catch. So it has the bonus to warp core scrams, which I am also a big fan of because again, it's part of the ship. It's part of the ship's character, so that makes a lot of sense. I like that approach to solving some of these problems, is if we need a ship to move ships safely, then there should be a ship for that and not a really lame module that we have to put in the load slots to do it. You know what I mean? So,
yeah, complicated decisions are the lifeblood of EVE, and I'm more than happy to add deeper vectors and
more
wider choices.
To it, right?
Like, so, because the wider the pool gets, the more opportunities we have to not just use the tools as expected, but combine them in new and exciting ways and build new metas. So, like, I really do appreciate that a lot of the design philosophy that I've seen over the last like year and a half, 2 years has been a lot less about directly like boost this 3% and nerf that 5%, has become more about, oh well, this segment sucks, so what if we used a new mechanic to add a relief valve to it, or what if we boosted a thing that's next to it so that people would move would move off of the sucky thing onto it, spread out a little bit further. And like Fozzie said this at Vegas, of something like the last thing I want to do, and I'm paraphrasing terribly, was that the last thing he wants to do when he's doing a change is just change the number that sucks. He wants to instead, like if there's something wrong with the economy, put something else in the system to buffer that out, rather than use a meat cleaver, especially when the sort of expertise required to do very hardcore hands-on economic reform is a skill set that doesn't really exist in the real world.
Right.
A lot of people claim they have it, but like it's such a complicated system of equations that most anybody who tells you they can fix the economy is lying to you.
Yeah.
Steve, do you have any thoughts about, you know, Warpcore stabs, interdiction nullified? Does this subject come up a lot at CSM meetings?
Well, interdiction nullification did come up. There were disagreements from a number of parties about what should happen with it, which actually led to the forum post I put up. Personally, I'm not a fan of Warpcore stabs in general. Mostly, it's the effect that I don't like, rather than the module itself. Like, if you're on a gate, I'm not so bothered. If you're, say, doing a faction warfare mission, that concerns me a bit more, because you've got people who are not taking part in the spirit of the thing.
Right.
They're doing the, I'm going to sit here and make money, and that's it. And
it feels very anti-Eve when people do that, doesn't it?
It does. Like, especially in Wormholes, Lulzsec, Nullsec. Maybe that's because it's so hard to find a balance between a PvP ship and a PvE ship. Like, Adventure, like, is definitely out there to make money. I'm not a big supporter of the +2 warp core strength, because it requires me to buy a 50 million warp scrambler to even get the thing. Like, you know, so I'm kind of against that whole thing, because either
you gotta use Alpha to kill the Ventures. That's the best thing. one shot them. They die really quickly.
Yeah, but then, you know, then again, I'm flying wormhole space. Right. They could see me coming a mile away.
That is true.
So, you know, you're always like, you always have like a problem. You know, so.
Which you should. I mean, it should always be a problem. There should always be a counter to any situation. Any ship should have a counter. Any situation that you could put yourself into should have a counter. There should be all of that. It's all about balance. It's all about keeping the game interesting. Well, for Locke's point, it's always the prey has to be interested as much as the predator does. And otherwise, there's an imbalance there. And if there's no prey, there won't be any predators. And if there's too many predators, there won't be any prey. So, you know, it's a way of... There's got to be a balance. It's just like nature, right? So
yeah, everybody needs to think they have the chance of winning. Everybody needs to believe they can win, even if that belief is wrong.
Right.
Well, you know, winning means a lot of different things for a lot of different people. Like for somebody else, winning might be making a lot of ISK and, you know, buying expensive stuff and flexing their accounts and flying faction ships. And they want to do it safely, and that's winning for them. Like, for me, winning is making awesome kills, and, I'm not personally looking at ISK efficiency, but more like ship efficiency and kill efficiency. You know, that's winning for me. Like, whenever I make a kill, that's, you know, that's awesome, and less worried about the PvE side of things. But you know, it's very difficult to balance for other people. But you know, I think I won't have a problem if they would remove or limit the amount of worker stabs that you can fit. You know, I would, you know, two, that's fine. I'll spend the 50 million ISK on a faction warp scram, like, you know, but. At least then I put something expensive on the line, and that person has to take risks. Like, that for me is a balance. They have to limit their abilities of being able to warp away, and I have to risk in a more expensive module to even catch it. So that balances out for me. That would be like a good in between. But yeah, you know, a lot of dads are using worker stabs. I mean, you've seen the posters, like, yep. They're out there. Yeah.
I'm up for just about anything as long as it's something. You know, we need a change. We need to ban them out of plexes. That would be great. We need to make them a burst module, so you use it. It's a one-time use, and then you have to throw them away. We need them to tie into the cap, so that they use cap energy when they run, so you can't keep just doing it all the time. Or it needs to be on a timer. I mean, there's probably 20 or 30 different solutions, and all of which sound pretty interesting, much more interesting than what we have currently. So I'm all for it. I don't want it to make it easier to kill anybody. I just wanted to make it make sense. So right now, to me, it just doesn't make any sense at all.
Steve, do you have any feelings coming from CCP? How they feel about that? So have you got a vibe from them?
Nothing I can talk about, I'm afraid.
Ah, interesting. Well, so there has been talk about it.
Don't take it to mean that necessarily.
He said we have to, now we get the sky's the limit.
Yeah, he said it, we're gonna hold him to it.
Oh yeah.
Now, Steve said all of these things that were not said.
Well, yeah. Steve was elected to the CSM specifically to do something about worker stamps, so we're still waiting. We got a couple more weeks.
Yeah. at least the discussion is going. Like, I mean, come on guys. Like, interdiction nullified discussions have been, you know, waging out there. So, at least it's a subject that comes up every once in a while.
Hey, Tyrant, I really appreciate you asking me onto the show, and I've had a great time, but I do have to step away now.
Yeah, I was actually going to wrap it up with shout-outs.
All right, cool.
I think we've covered everything that I wanted to cover. Let's do shout outs top to bottom, I guess. Phoenix, do you have any shout outs, mate? You've been very quiet this show.
Yeah, true. I want to thank everybody that's on here for coming. Wonderful show, I guess. Hope to see everybody soon.
Right, man. Yeah,
awesome.
It's time for you to come back to Eve, man. It's like you need to get back in the saddle.
That's a true fact.
All right, Logfox, man. Shout outs.
I guess I gotta give my shout outs to the Prosper community again. If you want to join us, Eve Prosper is the name to remember. I want to thank everybody who's running for CSM, both the work that Steve here has done, and we have a really great round of not null candidates that I'm really hoping we get a couple of them in, because my heart is going to be broken if we don't at least get a couple of these new voices read into the thing. And I want to thank you guys for having me on the show, because it's always fun to talk about this stuff.
All right, man.
Awesome.
Rix?
Yeah, no shout outs for me this time, but I would like to thank everybody for being on it and for having a chance to talk and not talk about some of the stuff that's been going on, which was awesome. So we went 2 hours without mentioning most of it, so I really appreciate that. And thanks to everybody who's listening. And you know what? I would shout out to Tyrant. I've seen his videos. They're really good. So, you know, everybody who's listening, please sub to Tyrant so he'll feel better about himself and share his videos. All right?
Yeah, numbers going up and to the right is the only validation any of us get.
That's exactly right. So thumbs up for Tyrant and do that for me. So that'll be great. All right, thanks, guys.
Thanks, man. Steve.
Thanks for having us on. I would like people to go vote, even if it's not for me, although obviously I'd prefer them to go vote for me. But just vote in general. Find people who believe the same kind of things as you do and vote for them.
What's the deadline? 28?
Off the top of my head, I'm not entirely sure.
I think it was the 28th of March. I don't remember.
It sounds kind of right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It does sound.
Obviously,
right.
Don't leave it until the very end in case it's wrong.
Yeah.
Vote now.
Guys. Yeah. 10 days, guys. And will you be at FanFest?
I will be, yes.
Okay, will your beard be at FanFest?
Yeah. At the very least, initially, yes.
It's probably, an excellent beard. It's a carry on, so yeah.
Yeah. If you don't get on, you know, live stream the shaving of the beard, please.
No promises.
All right, guys. Thanks
for
coming
cheers.
On.
Cheers.
My shout outs go to all of you guys, man. All the content creators out there. Keep going. Like myself. Like, don't get your don't feel down. And keep going. Keep making those videos, podcasts, and all that stuff. All the art. It's awesome. I want to thank everyone for listening. Play safe, and I'll see you next episode.